Looking for the king of podcasts? You're at the wrong channel. Looking for good ideas for life? You are far from good hands. If you think the listener is always right, you are far from the right place. Hosted by a Northeasterner by birth, a rebel by choice. If you want a host that floats between love and madness, then play on and listen to Crazy Train Radio.
You drive me wild.
What up, Crazy Train Radio?
You look like hell.
And I can look the same.
What's the photo for?
You want answers? I think I'm entitled.
You want answers?
I want the truth! You can't handle the truth!
Truth, 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 truth,
I love scotch. I love scotch. Scotch is got scotch. Here it goes down, down into my belly.
What's it open?
Say it! Say it!
Say it. 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 Say it.
Don't mess with me. I'm one crazy loofo.
Hey there, Friday fans. We know how much you enjoy the movies. Enjoy grabbing your Friday merchandise and interacting with the Friday family, whether it be at conventions or during our particular watch-alongs. Well, when you're looking to get yourself masks, why not check out our friends over at Camp Blood Customs out of New York State and order your specific custom mask from any of the films. All orders are made specifically. Your needs and wants are. Make sure you find Camp Blood Customs on Facebook, Instagram, and all over social media and order yours today.
Duff, your second favorite vampire, and you're listening to Crazy Train Radio.
Hey folks, it's your least favorite host in the podcast world, Croc. Jonathan Steele. Boy, do we have a good one for you today. Well, ladies and gentlemen, boys and girls, children of all ages. And the good thing about this next guest is she is from my neck of the woods of the Northeast. Even though she's a New Yorker, but we'll let her go for that. And I'm a Philly guy, as most people know. So, there is more than meets the eye with this lovely young lady. But most people who listen to us would be familiar with her as being a part of the Subspecies series. But like I said, there's more than meets the eye. As she has been a photographer, actress, a mother, a wife. Just so many different things. So let's go ahead and say hello to Miss Denice Duff. How are you doing?
Hey, I'm doing well. Thank you so much, by the way, for just your patience in getting this scheduled. And I love what you do. I love your interviews. I recently listened to Julie Michaels. I learned things about her, and she's one of my dearest friends that I didn't know because of your professional and insightful and enthusiastic knowledge.
And I will make sure that Denice is drug tested after we are done saying that or done this conversation, saying there's professionalism and stuff on my end. But thank you. I appreciate that.
It was all the cash that you gave me last week, right? I mean, that's what you told me to say, right?
Well, this is true. PayPal cleared. So
good.
And we'll start there because Denice is a recommendation from Miss Julie Michaels, who is one of the sweetest ladies I know and have gotten to know over the past few months. And Denice said she is a close friend of hers. And it was funny that when Julie first recommended you and tagged you in the initial email several months ago, what she just said there was exactly what she said in the email, in that as long as you guys had known each other, you were surprised to learn some things in the interview. So,
yep.
And I don't want to beat a dead horse, as they would say. But can I ask what some of those things were? Because I know some of it was a very deep and personal with her story, at least. And, you know, I know you guys have probably had conversations as friends. So,
sure. I mean, I met Julie many years back at a baby shower, and she was there for the birth of my daughter in my home. We both have children the same age, so they've grown up together, and we've just done a lot of the domestic parenting activities together, along with I directed a film called Vampire Resurrection that I had her in with the late Jeffrey Lewis. And but one of the things that she talked about in your interview was about her audition for Roadhouse. And I didn't know that she didn't really even have an agent at the time, or she had just met with someone else's agent and they said, hey, go to this audition, right? It was a friend. Or when she got it, like, she actually didn't want to do it initially. And I didn't know that whole backstory on this film that has become one of the most iconic credits on her resume.
And if I remember the story correctly, and actually, you know, if I'm quoting it right, I should say, is I'm the same way messing with the camera. I could so see I need an alignment bad by my chiropractor. It's scary. But the person that she had the issue with the night before that famous dance scene and all that we talk about was the person that she rode over to the audition with.
Yes.
So I was like, that's, yeah, but that is probably one of our most in-depth conversations and most very personal ones, I would say, as far as diving deep into somebody's background. So definitely recommend listening, and not because Julie bribed me.
Right. Her PayPal is very good too.
Yes. Even though it bounced back when I sent the invoice, but that's a whole nother thing. So we were initially going to do this while I was in Florida, not long after the watch along of Roadhouse. But however, you had, because I was in your neck of woods of Western Florida for a few days. However, you had made a quick trip out to LA.
It was just.
Yes. Two ships passing in the night.
And there is quite a lot of, there's some great horror film festivals, science fiction film festivals that go on in Tampa. And
I had come out here for several before, during the pandemic, I wound up moving here, you know, for the time being. And I will be doing a festival in a convention in July. My gosh, I forgot what it's called. A scream fest. But I will say that the few that I've done here, I've just been so impressed with the amount of filmmakers, horror filmmakers, and this filmmaking community that's here. And it's getting bigger. Certainly even since the pandemic, a lot of filmmakers have been coming to Florida, to Pinellas County area. There's been good tax incentives. And I actually just finished doing, when I was in Los Angeles, I auditioned for a film and films in Clearwater. And that's where I currently am. And it's a film for, it's either going to go to Lifetime or Hallmark. And I just thought it was so ironic that, you know, I go to LA for a few days to do some other work. I do an audition and the film actually books like practically in my backyard. So, you know, it just goes to show you that really anything can happen. And I think the world is at such a flux right now. And you can, you really can make art and be a part of things all over the world because of doing things right on Zoom. If you are in another country, you could still audition for things. All the auditions are now, you videotape yourself. It makes the world a little bit smaller. And I feel it really gives opportunity for anybody, anywhere to take part in the entertainment industry.
Exactly. And it's funny that you mentioned that as far as the convention circuit and everything in Florida. But before we touch on that a little bit, you just said you moved down to where you're at during the pandemic. So what was it that attracted you to the Clearwater, Pinellas County area there?
Well, not a super happy story. It was literally just before the pandemic happened. My mother had moved here from Los Angeles and she got lung cancer. She kind of left us pretty fast and had a little home here. And I was starting a skincare business amongst all the other things that I was doing as a photographer and a director and an actress. I had moved to Manhattan for a few years in 2017, 2018, and in 2019. And I was doing the skincare business, but I'd fly back to LA every month to do work there. But I really wanted to continue this. And when my mother passed, it was like, wow, we have a free house in Florida, and let's give it a shot. It wasn't going to be long-term. And 2 months after we moved here, the pandemic hit. And so we weren't going to move back to Manhattan. And I wasn't going to move back to Los Angeles because both of those cities were very closed down. And here I was in the Tampa Clearwater area. And I was able to afford investing more into my skincare business. And it's a bit of an irony because, you know, I do these fan conventions and, you know, when I was a vampire, people really think that I'm a vampire because, you know, at 55 years old, I'm not looking it too much. And so, you know, when I sell my face cream, it's like it really is eternal face cream. But being down here in the Tampa Clearwater area has allowed me to continue doing that business. And then the agents that I got, I'm still able to audition for things all over the U.S. You know, I auditioned for a lot of TV shows that tape in Georgia. And so for now, this has been a very good place to be as an artist and as an entrepreneur.
And, you know, it's funny because you were talking about things being done over Zoom and stuff like that, which we're on now. But it made me think of a conversation I recently had probably about a month or so ago. It's out there now. Pandemic Pillow Talk, which is a virtual series that they're doing where it was like a online dating kind of deal. And Eric Roberts and his wife, Elise, is involved in it. It was a cool concept. But you mentioned about the project in Clearwater there that you got hired to do and stuff.
Yeah.
But does that make you feel better that
at the end of the workday, you could come home, sleep in your own bed, shower in your own bath. You know, just had certain comforts of your own house that you wouldn't have in a hotel room.
You know, I have such a wandering spirit, and I'm such an adventurer, and that I will say, you know, living in LA all my life and working on films there was super fun. But I do have to say, along with many of my fellow actors, we really love booking jobs that are on location. You know, fortunately, we're put in decent hotel rooms, and there's something really fun. You know, I don't keep a TV in my bedroom. I never have. And so it is kind of fun to have a TV in your room when you're in a hotel. I'm not doing laundry, you know, when I'm working on a film and I have to come home, I've still have to deal with my day-to-day activities of like, oh, I've got to fix that molding, or, oh, I've got, you know, so being on location really does have quite an excitement to it. And when you think of as an actor, we don't work Monday through Friday, 9 to 5, 300 days out of the year.
Yeah.
And, you know, it's kind of like the game of golf. I saw a t-shirt for golf that said, I hate golf. I hate golf. I hate golf. Nice shot. I love golf. And, you know, it's like with acting, it's, you know, my God, I've auditioned, I'm auditioning. I'm going to give up. I booked a job. I love this. And, so you spend way more time not working and working on getting your craft than you do when you do it. So, you know, I was on a soap opera. I was on Young and Restless for about a couple of years. And that was the closest thing to having a 9-to-5 job, because on a soap opera, you know, it's local to you. Occasionally there are some special day players that may fly in for a part. And ironically, Radu, who's played by Honest Hove, has a recurring role on General Hospital. And he was on General Hospital in 1993 when one of the main characters on it, who was already cast, they needed to find their evil vampire. And a character named Michael Watson, who played Stefan, the character who my character falls in love with, was on General Hospital and said, hey, there's an actor that's on our show. He's a Danish guy who comes in from time to time playing a character named Faison. I think he'd make a great evil vampire. And that was Honest. And he came and auditioned and got it. And so, but the soap operas are some of the closest form to having a 9-to-5 job. Mm-hmm. You don't work every day. Not every character's on the soap, every single storyline, you know, there are breaks in it, but you'll pretty much work 2 to 4 days a week, which is a lot for an actor. And soap operas don't have, they don't have hiatuses. It's not like we're going to do 8 weeks or 10 weeks and then shut down. They're 24/7. So that was the closest thing when I was on the soap to having that 9-to-5 job. And it was really sweet. You know, you looked forward to your weekends and having family time. Whereas when I was done with that soap, I hated my weekends. And prior to the soap, I hated my weekends because those were days that I couldn't audition. Those were days I didn't have an opportunity to book a job. And I think that's one of the differences with having a job that you love so much that a Sunday for most artists isn't a day to just relax. You know, it's a day to what can I create more on my passion, whether it's my short film I'm doing. Oh my gosh. I know it's boring. It's
No, you're good. I had a 5 and a 3-year-old that wore me out. So go ahead.
Oh yes. Yes. So, of course I did love what I loved about having a job here is here. I'm living in this sleepy, sort of retirement community of Clearwater, Bel Air, Bluff, where you don't drive around and see films being filmed. And that's been my entire life living in Los Angeles and Manhattan. You know, it's just photo shoots are happening. You're constantly being detoured because, oh, who's filming now? What movie's filming now? And now it's for the first time in my life that I'm living in a place where they don't film. So the fact that that's starting to happen now, it was super exciting to come home and to get ready for my morning time on the set. So yes, that it's the film is called Love's Playlist, and it was directed and starring a gal named Brittany Underwood, And she's done been in a lot of different TV shows. Brittany Underwood, an amazing director, singer, and an actress, mainly an actress who's segueing into being a director.
And you mentioned the doing a few conventions and stuff. And obviously, like I said, most people who listen to us anyway would be familiar of Subspecies series.
Yeah.
So with that being said, the conventions and all, the few you've done, what was the most unique fan interaction I would say you have coming to a show and stuff?
Oh gosh. Well, certainly the one of my highlight ones was a couple of years ago when I had come to a convention in Tampa. I'm signing someone's autograph and a guy walks by and he says, "Denice Duff." And I said, "Yes." And he said, "Hey, I remember you from Los Angeles from 20 years ago. I used to work at the gym on La Brea and Hollywood Boulevard, and you would come in all the time reading scripts, and you'd be on the Stairmaster or treadmill." And he said, "You were the only actress I knew that worked all the time, and you were the only one that was really nice to me." And I was like, "Oh my gosh, yeah, of course I remember you." And he goes, "I'm an agent here in Tampa. If you ever move here, you've got an agent." And 5 months later, my mother passed, and 8 months later, I wound up moving to Tampa. And of course, Shelby became my agent. And that was just sort of a sweet small town. Like you never know who you're going to meet again in this life. I really feel like there are 13 people I meet and we just keep sort of recycling who knows who. I get third generation. I get someone who would watch Subspecies with their grandfather. And so, you know, I've got this 12-year-old boy I'm signing an autograph, and he's there with his 35-year-old father, and next to them is his 75-year-old father. And so it's these three generations that have watched Subspecies, and the fact that now with the internet and with all sorts of streaming, it just, you know, it used to be that people would steal the Blockbuster VHS copy.
What's going on?
They confiscated everything, even the stuff we didn't steal.
And would bring that to, you know, the Chiller convention or Fangoria, these conventions I would do. And I would sign, you know, begrudgingly, these Blockbuster copies of VHSs. And because they were just hard to get, they were hard for people to see. But now people get to see them on Tubi or, you know, YouTube. So, you know, now it's more about taking pictures, chatting with them, telling stories. And I love to hear their feedback. That's what makes doing horror films better than doing any romantic comedy, is because horror film fans are the most invested in the storylines of any genre of film.
And for the most part, and overall, the horror fan base always seems like it's one of the most well-read and intelligent fan bases, and absolutely, not just within the horror genre, but
across
that's multiple.
I say that quote all the time when people who aren't as familiar with this genre and other actor friends of mine who haven't experienced that, I always say, these fans are the most well-read. They are extremely intelligent, and no, they're not stalking me. They're truly interested in not only the work that I put into the film, but the work that I did to prepare for it. And then just interested in as a person. You know, they love to weave in your personal life with your cinema, you know, your real life, your R-E-E-L life with your R-E-A-L life. And I have found that far more than even with having done soap operas.
And it's funny you say that, because I actually watched this morning. I finally had an opportunity because I have the watch-a-thon or whatever it's called from Showtime and some of them, thanks to Xfinity. But I just watched 13 Fanboy, which was done by friend of the show, Deborah Voorhees.
Mm-hmm.
And it hints on that topic that you're talking about, weaving in the real life compared to the film life and TV, the celebrity life per se.
Yep. Yep.
You know, it was, and I know some people didn't participate in the film from certain horror franchises because, and I totally understand because of the having real life issues with, whether it be stalkers or, you know, just they've had some serious stories. So, you know, I mean, mm-hmm. For them, it would have been overstepping
right.
a certain line, which I totally good. But as a picture, it was very well done. Deborah did an awesome job. Love Deborah to death. Did a lot of it in New Mexico there, which was awesome.
So great.
Yeah. So if you have a chance to check that out, 13 Fanboy folks. And as you were, yeah, it's on Showtime. So if you have Showtime, okay. you should be able to check it out there.
Okay.
And as far as the things being, or fans being well read and stuff, this is all for show. Most of them were picture books because my parents didn't want me to know how to read and write.
Hey, as a photographer, I love me good photos. All the good pictures, you know?
Yeah. I'm picture right, I'll say.
There you go. Picture is 1,000 words. We know that.
Yes. And yeah, we'll leave that be. But speaking of subseries and whatnot that mm-hmm. people know you from, and we know everything on the internet is true. But
of course.
Oh, 100%. That's a tongue in cheek that I always go usually with most episodes. But is there truth that they are working on a part five?
Oh gosh, it's been written for 12 years. 2019, we got the go ahead to do it. The script was released. 2020, June 17th, I had a ticket to fly to Albania to begin it. But because as we know, in June of 2020, people weren't filming. And then it got pushed to 2021. And then it got pushed again to August 29th of this year. We are going to go to Serbia to do part five. And it will be a prequel. So it's going to take place like 1,000 years before the part one even started. So you're going to find out how Reggie became a vampire. You're going to find out how my character, Michelle, who was basically just a college student who fell in love with this half vampire guy and then gets, you know, he dies and she gets tangled up with his evil brother. And so you're going to find out, I play my earlier lifetime version of my character, which is good because 25 years in between these two films, if I played the same character, you know, so it's going back in time. And so they're going to Serbia because Serbia has the old castle because it's taking place in like, actually more like the 1500s. So it's going back more than 1,000 years. It's taking place around the 1400s to the 1600s. So there'll be horses and it'll be very, very Crusades era. It's should be really badass.
Right. So obviously I know there'd be a little bias here, but from what you've read script wise and story and everything, are you excited about it? Is it?
Oh gosh. It's like a Game of Thrones episode. You know, it's poetry. Like a dungeon of vampires to horses and monks and musicians. It's such a beautiful story. The evolution, it has Vladislaus, the king of the vampires, a little bit of humor, but really just a dark, beautiful, well-told story. And the reason it's taken this long is because Full Moon Pictures went, the budgets just got much smaller, like in the last 10, 15 years. When we shot the Subspecies series, it was partially produced by Paramount Pictures. So, you know, there were a few million dollars to be put on the screen for these films. And they weren't, even though they might have been considered B-movies back in the 90s and later, a B-movie could cost a couple million dollars. Now, you know, you can make an A movie with a half a million, you know? Mm-hmm. So with video and so the director, Ted Nicolau, didn't want to compromise and shoot it in America because the first four were shot in Romania. And this one, it goes back even further in time and really needs those old castles and cobblestone streets in Serbia. So that's what also took a long time, was raising the money within the production company themselves. And then when the pandemic hit, filmmaking got a lot more expensive, because if you're following all the COVID protocols, it's just more money. Everything is just more expensive. So that put a, that kind of kept pushing us. But all along, you know, I've got my script. I've been working on my hair pieces. I've got my costume, and it's this glorious, you know, I've got a few of them that, that were made for me 2 years ago. So this is going down.
That is good. Were some of those outfits done by our mutual friend that is also friendly with Miss Michaels?
Yes, Desi Designs. Desi Designs made my dresses, just hand stitched onto me, just every little detail. She worked on even aging, you know, the leather, and even things that you had to think of with these puffy sleeves and these like very tight arms, and they're made of certain materials, but they started to be very loud. They made like loud sounds. And when you're filming, you have to think of those things that you can't, you, even though the material may be authentic, if it's going to ruin the sound for the actor every time they talk.
Mics and all that. Yeah,
that's right. So we had to create an authentic material, but that wasn't going to be every time I moved and talked. So I love those things. Even on the original films, when we shot Subspecies, my character, even though it takes place in current days, the character goes into an old opera house, and she had bust out of an ambulance because she made her way into a hotel room and fell asleep in the bathtub, curled up, and just had on, like, you know, a little t-shirt. And so when she, the housekeepers thought she was dead in the film, and they put her in an ambulance, and she winds up waking up because she's a vampire and runs out of the ambulance and goes into an old opera house. And that's where the character, and Ted, the writer, was just so brilliant in, how do you get a character in really beautiful clothes? You have to write it into the script. Like, if you're a good writer, so people aren't like, hey, where'd she get that beautiful gothic outfit from? So she goes into the basement of this opera house, where there's a glass gilded coffin where she slept, but emerged from it in this beautiful linen, puffy sleeves and beautiful draping skirt and velvet. Well, the detail work on it was such that it was so old, it didn't even have zippers. So every day the seamstresses had to sew the dress on me and had to cut it off of me every day of work. It had to be hand sewed on and then cut off. Even when I would get, when I would bite a victim, because they only had one of these particular dresses, when they would bite me, I had to remember where the blood was, because we didn't have a double or a triple of these outfits. So when they would hand wash it for the next day and we had to continue the bite scene, I would have to make sure that I pushed my chest up to the guy in the right way so that the blood could come the right way. And anyway, it's just,
there's a spot on my left shoulder, and there's
instead
this,
of the right.
The little details on, you know.
Yes. Yes. So I loved doing all that, you know. A scene where I'm drinking from the Bloodstone, and that was a contraption that was made in the storyline so that the character doesn't have to kill for blood, and it drips the blood of the saints. And so on my very first scene where I'm drinking from the Bloodstone, we had a wire up my shirt, like it went, you know, all the way through. Look, this is my charging cord. And it went into the Bloodstone. And so I'm drinking from the Bloodstone, and a guy from around the corner, the special effects pumps the blood, right? So just when there were two cables, one had electricity, so it made a light glow. And then right after the light glows, the blood starts to come. And the director just wanted a couple little drops And I'm staying there and I'm like this, and it's this beautiful close up and the blood's not coming on my tongue. And it's very quiet, the quiet on the set, you know, and all of a sudden I feel my back is really cold and wet. And the cable, which was going down my back, the piping had a connector and it burst open and all the blood was pooling on my back. And so we had to cut. And the makeup artist, I mean, this is just the epitome of filmmaking in this genre. He wound up just hiding down behind me and just blowing it with his mouth at, as we were in for the close-up on the take, you know, because to try and repair it. And it was a Hudson sprayer, you know, and it just popped it apart. So I love all that.
It almost sounds like the story from the original Friday the 13th with Kevin Bacon, where whoever was doing the blood effect when he got killed, extra blowing to push everything through, and it made it look better.
Oh, yes. Yes, that's in fact my very first bite that I had to do to a victim. The director wanted me to like throw up the blood, right? Like it was, you know, too much, too putrid for my character, right? My very first kill. And so I just didn't want it to look, I don't know, I just didn't want it to look bad. I wanted it to be like really kind of offensive. So when it came to get ready for the take, they give you, you know, a little bottle in a sprayer and they have you to just drink some of it. And he gives me some to drink. And I'm like, this isn't enough. Like, I'm just going to go, you know, especially because the scene just before where I'm sucking the guy's blood, the director really had me like heaving. So if I'm going to now break away, go down on the ground, I want this to be something. So I grabbed the blood bottle and I like, and I took so much and I'm like, and I get down there and I start to swallow just a little bit, because even though it's not bad for you, I don't know if you ever tasted like fake blood, like film blood.
No, I haven't.
No. So it's like glycerin. It's just super sweet. And all that red dye can be very bitter. So it's like bitter and sweet. And so I had it in my mouth and I didn't want to let it out right away. Right. And the character's on all fours and I just didn't know how it was going to cough out. And I just thought, okay, what's a real throw up like? It's when you can't help it. It's not a real throw up. Isn't you necessarily spitting it out. It's your body rejecting it. Mm-hmm. So I purposely swallowed a little bit and it just made me gag and went, and it just splat. And all of a sudden, like the set went from being quiet to fuck yeah.
That's awesome.
Yeah. Yeah. And I turned around. It was like, that was my first induction into the horror film. Like, okay, she's going to be okay with these blood scenes.
Yeah, this is going to work.
Right.
So diving a little further back off the series, when you were just getting your start as a actress and whatnot, I heard that you really didn't understand the hustle of the entertainment business and really was on a learning curve. And when I say hustle, it's not like she was out hustling on the street corners in New York, because obviously she did some school time in LA, then went to NYU. So what was that like learning the hustle of the entertainment business?
Yeah, that's a good question. So yes, I did go to New York University and I studied directing and I studied photography and came back to LA when I was 19. And I started to work for a photographer part-time doing hair and makeup while I was going out on auditions. And I realized quickly that when I'd worked for this photographer, he photographed actors. And I knew that if I could just get my foot in a door in front of an agent, that I would be able to book an agent, because it's one of those elusive things. You, in this business, you can't just go, hey, I'd like to be an actor, can I have an agent? It isn't like, hey, I'd like to be an American Horror Story, knock, knock, hi, I'd like to be on your show. And so But I just knew that if I could get in front of an agent, I would be able to get represented, because I would mail in my stuff and make phone calls, and that didn't always work. And so I found ways to get to meet people face to face by actually delivering other people's proof sheets. And that actually got me an agent. It got me three that I was able to choose from. I found that I needed to do a little research and find out what do people like. And, you know, it was kind of the old fashioned way of like, oh, I found out this guy really likes this age old whiskey, this agent, I'm going to leave a headshot with a bottle of this whiskey, at the front of, you know, his office. This guy can't eat wheat. Oh, okay. What kind? There it is. Oh, okay. See, there are certain, what?
No, I was going to say, how did you know I was a whiskey drinker? But
because I could smell it.
Wow, that's bad. I need to hit the shower then.
No, you paid me enough. You're fine.
Okay.
So I would go in deeper in a personal connection to find out, like, even someone's background, like, oh, he's also from New York, or he's also Italian. And I would use that knowledge to make connections. And I never took anything lightly if I would go to some party, or even as a waitress, you know, I waited on Jeff Goldblum when he was dating Gina Davis. And, you know, I said that, you know, and at the time everyone thought I looked like Gina Davis. And he said, oh, but you have cuter dimples. I didn't really like that then. I didn't really like that he complimented me over his girlfriend, wife, whatever she was back then, but that's okay. He has a really great show.
Can you appreciate it now?
I can appreciate it now. I you know, and I think he might have had a flirty time back then, and this is like 30 years ago. You know, guys do those kind of things. I don't think he was, anyway. But I did take the cheese from his hamburger that he didn't eat, and I put it in a Ziploc bag. And I brought it to my acting class that night, and I did a comedy skit with the cheese that had one bite mark out of it. And I did a little commercial, like, because we were doing improv night at my acting class that night. So when they were done eating, he had taken just one bite out of his burger, and then he took the cheese off and put it to the side. And I kept that cheese. I actually forgot about that pretty much until just now.
How about that?
Don't judge. Don't judge.
No. And Jeff, you know, your food was wonderful. Helped get some gigs and training. But
see,
we'll try to look at the positive of this.
Yes. Yes. So I, you know, using those sort of tools to really get to know someone more than just to get to know them more. And still to this day, I do that. I do that through social media. You know, I get to you look at their pages, and I will for 2 years I was a talent agent in Los Angeles, and I would have some actors come for representation, and there were several of them that brought the box series of Subspecies, and a lot of the other agents thought, like, oh my God, isn't that creepy? And I said, absolutely not. I said that meant that actor did a little research, found out other things that I've done. And I said, I think it's kind of cool. I said, creepy would be if they came to my house in their underwear and knocked on my door. You know, like, there's a big difference between doing some research, finding out something about someone that you may have in common, a love of horror film, a love of Earl Grey tea, or a certain kind of whiskey. You know, maybe you both were adopted, you know, maybe you both fight for, you know, certain animal rights, whatever that thing is that you can connect with that other person is going to endear you to them. And we all want to work with people who we like and love. And, you know, I teach actors, I do little business seminars, I just volunteer, and I do them about 3 or 4 times a year for the last 20 years. And that's one of the most important things I say, is that actors and directors, they're no different than us. It's like, wouldn't we all just love to, like, hang out with our college buddies and do films for the rest of our lives? And you look at, you know, the Ben Stillers or the Vince Vaughns, who've, you know, they kind of keep a lot of the same cast together, right?
Adam Sandler.
right? And that was before, like, the, like, okay, you get the Marvel series where they have to keep using those people. But when you're doing different films, but you're keeping your buddies with you, it may not be because they're the best actor, but you dig each other.
There's a certain comfort to it, too.
It's exactly right. So you want to be like, I always felt like I wanted them to trust that the not only the professionalism, but the fun that you can bring to someone on the set. And that to me is just like, because everybody likes to have fun and, you know, life is too serious and making a film can be serious. It's more serious than watching a film, but the film will be as fun as it is if based on the fun that you have making it, even if it's like dark and difficult, there's a joy because you're creating something that's meaningful. And I really, that's one thing that I really learned about this business. It's not like just working at a bank.
Yeah, exactly. Well, I do have to say this, that you made me pop when I was doing some homework and reading and all that stuff, because I had to ask my five-year-old niece to read it to me, the stuff online. I'm just kidding, folks. I really didn't have her do that. But on your website, denicestuff.com, the thing that got me excited and made me laugh a little bit was you were talking about the, in your about section and talking about yourself and fluffing yourself up, which why not pump yourself up? But in the biography, you were talking about the TV commercials that you've done, like Chex, Party Mix, and Fruit of the Loom, and Budweiser, and all that stuff. And you put in quotes, which certainly helped pay the bills and bought my house. I love the candor and honesty with that, because, and I've heard, well, I love that because most people would be like, oh, you know, try to hide certain things they did. But people don't realize, if we're being honest here, the amount of money you can make doing commercial work, especially when you're with national brands, whether it be Budweiser, Fruit of the Loom, you know, these nationwide and sometimes worldwide brands.
Yeah.
So I appreciate it the way you wrote that.
Yeah, I mean, it goes in the other way too, because when I was an agent for 2 years, a lot of people wanted their children. I want to get my kid into the business. I want him to make some college money, right? And that was kind of a phrase that you hear a lot. Yeah, I just want them to make some, you know, just some money for college. But I always sort of disabuse them of the idea of just going into it for the money, because the amount of auditions that it took for me to book even the dozen that might have made $500,000, the dozens and dozens and dozens that you have to go on. Like, if you book one or two national commercials a year, that's really freaking good, right? Obviously now national commercials, they make them so fast. They've created buyouts. Because there's so many different channels. So you get paid a little less now, but there's a lot more commercials, right? It mm-hmm. used to just be one TV, 10 stations. So I always tell parents too, to just know that it's a long runway and you have to really love it. And you've got to have another job to pay your bills. And for a long time, I was a freelance makeup artist, and that's what I did. In fact, even when I was on The Young and Restless, I had segued into doing photography, really because I love it. And it was a nice way to make extra cash. And there's lots of, you know, there's lots of foundations I like to donate to. I like to be able to help out friends. I never wanted to be able to just get by. I wanted to be able to help donate when I could. And so when I set my garage up as a photo studio, I was on the soap opera and I might've been making like $3,000 a day on the soap opera, but I couldn't wait to come home and do a photo shoot to an actor for $300. And, you know, they'd knock on the door and I'd hi. And they're like, I just saw you on my TV today at lunchtime. And I'm like, oh, right on, come on in. And so you just need to keep many sources of income coming in, regardless of what they were. And so my photography job was definitely a way to make sure my bills got paid, to make sure that, you know, I could have clean teeth, you know, keep my hair halfway decent, you know, nice clothes, and, you know, a car that runs, insured, gas, and a roof over your head. And so whatever that took, doing makeup for people, doing photography, I used to sell flowers in nightclubs when I was 20, 21 and starting out, in between going on auditions. And I'll never forget the day that I stopped selling flowers in nightclubs, because I had enough commercials and enough residuals coming in. And that I cried that night where I didn't go out, because I just kept thinking of all my girlfriends that were out there going from nightclub to nightclub with all the cigarettes and, you know, and all the guys hitting on you. But we'd make a few $100. But I didn't have to do that anymore. And I got to go out to dinner with my husband, and I got to just sit on the couch and watch TV if I wanted to. But you work your butt off for that, you know, and then there's a new level. Then you're like, oh, you know, I'd like to buy a house. Okay, now we've got to do more commercials, or we've got to make another form of income. What else do you like to do? Photography. So I've always pushed my creative level to a demand that I need to do. And whether it was I wanted to, create a video for a friend and have the money for that, so that we could make it a really good quality, that would push me to go out on more auditions, you know?
Goes back to my previous question there, as far as learning the hustle of it. And it's kind of where I'm going, and I like to be blunt with the show, trying to figure out how I can take this post-COVID. There's never been a huge budget for us, being a one man, you know, writing, directing, producing, the hosting, everything. But so, in a sense, learning the hustle so I can take the show on the road. We got a couple of things going on that want to do and accomplish, but it's how do we get there from point A to point B? But you mentioned your husband, Michael, who I heard a little rumbling that he was in a band. So how did you hook up with Michael, as far as, was it seeing the band, or where did he come in there in a play?
I was 21 and I was waitressing at a 50s diner in Sherman Oaks, California. And he had just moved from Boston to Los Angeles to work for a music company called Marshall Amplifiers. It was Marshall Amplifiers and Korg Keyboards. And he was a singer-songwriter, but working as a businessman for Marshall Amplifiers and would go out, was an artist rep. And he'd come into the restaurant, the 50s restaurant, all the time. And I just thought he was super cute. And so that's how I met him. And I asked him out on a date first. He was 22. I was 21. And so we got married. And a few years after we got married, he put a band together and they started performing a lot. And then I got pregnant. And when our daughter was, they used to practice all the time when I was pregnant. And then when about a year after she was born, I remembered, you know, starting to make phone calls on the band's behalf. And I would call Columbia Records and Capitol Records, A&M, Radioactive. I'd call these labels and I would just say, hello, my name is Denice Marie. I work for the band Chalk Farm and I wanted to send you a cassette. And I literally would be so scared, but I would write it down. I made a script and I didn't use my last name Duff. I would just say Denice Marie. And I had a little chalkboard and I would write down who I called. And I remembered the third record label that I called. And I would get a name of a name. I had just done hair and makeup to some manager. And the manager had repped, some rap star. And he said, look, you should call call so-and-so at A&M at their Charlie Chaplin studio, ask them what the code word is, because they've got a little code you can put on the envelope when you send it in. Okay, good. Get that. Write the name down. So I said, hi, I'm Denice Marie. Yes, I just am friends with Joe Blue, and he recommended that I send you a cassette of the band that I represent, Chalk Farm. Great. Okay. And you're still at blah, blah address. Excellent. What's the, just give me what the code word is that I should put on the envelope. I made it like, I already know this. Right. And he's like, oh, something like Tropical Punch. Great. Tropical Punch. So I took that phrase. I called up this other A&R rep at another music company. I said, hi, you know, my name is Denice Duff. Look, I'm friends with Joe. I didn't even know if this guy knew someone, but he was big enough. And I said, yeah, I've just met with him. He told me that I should send you guys a cassette of a band I work with, Chalk Farm. Do you guys have a little code that I can put on the envelope when I send it to make sure it ensures it gets to you? And they were like, yeah, just put in twice Apple, whatever. Great. Thank you. So I just went in there throwing out names, assuming that that they also had a code. And really, players just want to play with players who know the rules. You know, don't call them up. Don't ever call up and go, hi. Hi, how are you? Who is this?
Yeah.
Hey, I'm Denice. How are you doing? Can I help you? Like, nobody cares to answer the question, how are you doing? I don't even know who you are. They have this much time. Get to the point.
Exactly.
And get to the point in a professional way. Right? Like for you, you know, hi, my name is Denice Duff. I was referred to you by Julie Michaels. I'm an actress. I've done horror. I've got an upcoming film in the franchise that I've done. And I think maybe it would be great publicity if you think of my client or me to be on your next podcast series. Boom. Like,
get to the point and what's the goal? What's all that fun stuff?
Right?
Exactly. You know,
it's super sexy, really.
And here you go. I was just thinking about this too, as being to the point and stuff. And you would get this being spent time in New York and stuff. And how we are in the Northeast, Philadelphia, New York, Jersey, all that fun stuff. That the time I lived in Florida when I started this in 2012, for the few months I was down there, and I was working at a theme park. I went to order food, and the way they were advertising the food, it's like, dude, they don't make that. It was a cheesesteak and stuff. I said, dude, you don't do it that way. He goes, you're pretty blunt. You're kind of an asshole. Like I said, I wasn't being blunt. I was, you know how we are. We're down in this. We're just matter of fact to the point. And it was like, the guy was from Central Florida his whole life. Wasn't used to that bluntness.
Yeah.
You know, it's a totally different personality.
Yeah.
You know?
Yeah, it is. It's nothing. No one succeeds like the New Yorkers. You know, they get stuff done. You know, LA is a very different vibe, but what keeps it going is.
Sorry, I'm laughing. Your cat fell.
Oh my God. I'm trying to ignore this little guy. I'm trying to ignore him. I'm trying to be professional. In Los Angeles, they're very driven, but it does have a little bit more of a laid back vibe. And when I moved I'm originally from New York, but my family moved to Los Angeles when I was 5. And that's where I lived my entire life until the last few years ago when we decided to move to Manhattan, my husband and I. And so many people in LA couldn't believe, why would you move back? Why would you move to New York? People move out of New York. Why would you move to Manhattan? You know, you're a grown-up. Grown-ups don't move back to Manhattan. They you know, enjoy the laybackness of Los Angeles. And I said, you know, I think a few people have been okay and survived the cold weather and the blunt people. And, you know, I think people can still be productive in Manhattan. And then they'd be like, oh, well, I mean, yeah. And I'm like, yeah, because like it is not a sleepy town. Now, where I'm at now is a bit of a sleepy town, although, you know, Tampa's starting to pick up. But it was just exhilarating. I would look out my window. I lived in an apartment in Hudson Yards, and you're looking out and you're seeing photo shoots going on, and you're seeing films going on, and you're seeing people pulling giant couches down the street and mannequins for fashion design and, you know, wild art paintings being, you know, everything is in the street because you've got to do a lot of walking. So you're mm-hmm. constantly motivated. And I really feel that, you know, if anyone listening is feeling a little stuck creatively, you've got to get out and get into a metropolis area, even if it's just for a couple of days, and just see life happening at its fullest and see humanity going on, because it's really the best way to get inspired.
Exactly. And a change of scenery helps the creativity, that's for sure.
It does.
And I had you on just about an hour, but okay. My last question for you is, and I appreciate the time, Denice. And well, actually, I got two questions because I want to tie a bow on something we started with. But first one being, along the way, the different beats, and I know these to be legit because of not only this thing called the internet, but you got a chance to work with, and I know people might younger than me really may not know the name, but would know the show, Andy Griffith. You worked with him on Matlock, but also Mark Harmon. And both gentlemen gave you great tips that you used for your acting career. So what was this?
Wow. You're so good. You are so good. Okay, gosh, podcasters of America, please check out this host here and hire him and pay him lots of money. Okay, Andy Griffith. We'll start with Andy Griffith. Andy Griffith, first of all, even in his late 60s, being the star of a show, would come to the set with all of his lines completely memorized, pages upon pages, while day players who'd have one or two pages still had to look down at their script. He was one of the first people I knew who requested vegetable juicers to be put in the makeup trailer because he really cared about his crew being healthy. He would sit and talk and ask questions about my personal life. And it was the first time I experienced such a super celebrity who's been through every decades of filming, actually gave a shit about this little 23-year-old actress and wanted to know about my life. Ironically, I did get to tell him that we lived on the same block when I was 6 years old, and I actually had gotten his autograph, and he didn't even know that. So for me, it was a real kind of coming home thing. But he really showed me that professionalism is a timeless quality. And also he sort of showed me a little, he had this charm and this sex appeal about him, which, you know, I suppose maybe now in today's climate might come across different, but he just was always very playful in a sweet way. He was very complimentary, but never crossed any line, just 100% professional, but enjoyed working on that set. Mark Harmon, I worked with him on a TV show called Reasonable Doubts. And that was a show where he and Marlee Matlin were detectives on it. And I had a starring role on one of the episodes. Now, at that point, I had done several films. You know, I had done Hell Comes to Frogtown, and I'd done...
Go ahead. It just registered another question. Go ahead.
I had done Hell Comes to Frogtown Part 2 with Bobby Zadar, who's Maniac Cop. I played Spangle, and with Brian James. And it was directed by, we'll leave that. So I'd been working. I've done national commercials at this point. So now I'm on this set. I'd done Matlock, which was a a two-part episode. So I was on the show for quite a while. And now I'm on Reasonable Doubts. And Mark Harmon was the star of it. Now I'm in hair and makeup, and they call in to say Mark is going to be late because he is helping a woman on the 405 freeway who got a flat tire. Now, at the time, cell phones weren't super popular, and he had a cell phone. So he pulled over to help this woman and waited there until a fire truck came to help her, because the 405 freeway is kind of vast. And so I already had this great opinion of him, even though I knew nothing of him prior to that. And so I had finished filming a scene, and I'm on the sound stages, and I'm walking around the sound stages. I'm away from where they're filming, and I'm walking through other fake rooms, and I'm looking at things, and Mark Harmon shows up, and I asked him a question, kind of a simple question. And I just felt like getting into communication, and it's part of my tool. Whenever I work, is to find out something about a person, get in communication with them, find something to ask a question about. So I ask him this question, and he says, "Oh, is this your first job?" Right? Not in a demeaning way. And the way he said it, it made me think, wow, he really wants to help. And I want to accept his help. So I said, "Yes, actually it is." Now, and, you know, I could justify it's my first job on Reasonable Doubts, that TV show. Well, for the remaining week and a half of shooting, he would help me with tips of how to stay in your light so that you don't get a shadow. He gave me tips on how to hit my mark. So for example, like if this is where I need to end up for this scene and the light is good, he would tell me, keep your body right there and just rock out of frame. And just totally rock out of frame. And then when you come in, you're set. Keep your feet there and rock out. And then boom, you don't have to worry about walking up to it. So he gave me these little pointers of what it's like being on a set. And because he just really cared about an actor doing well. Another actor who was super helpful was Caruso, David Caruso from CSI Miami. And apparently sometimes he had gotten a bad rap, I had heard. And, but on the particular set, there was one day where I guess, there was something going on with the production, and he refused to come out on set until the crew members were given something that they were requesting, until they were given their rights for something. So they were being good to the actors, but the crew was kind of getting shit on. And David Caruso, the star of CSI Miami, really stood up for them. And so I really loved hearing these little stories about these celebrities who really don't have to do that. So those are my faves.
But what I was thinking of when you mentioned Hell Comes to Frogtown.
Yeah, I can't just drop that.
Yes, and the reason you made me think of that, or what you made me think of, was one guy I always wanted to talk to, but unfortunately didn't happen, was Roddy Piper.
Yeah.
So did you have much interaction with him?
I didn't have much interaction with him because I replaced Sondel Bergman in part one as Spangle. And Bobby Zadar, Robert Zadar, replaced Rowdy Roddy Piper in part two. We got to see each other at some conventions. I believe he came by the set one day. I know that I had an interaction with him, and I think it might have been when we were out like at this desert ranch. We had our jet packs and this crazy scenes. We were flying. There were frogs. Lou Ferrigno was in it. And Lou Ferrigno, what? Do you like him? Don't like him?
No, because of the green, it makes sense.
The green, exactly. And he just found it. He's like, in the makeup chair, he's like, here I am again, getting green. You know, he just took everything with such a grain of salt, really such a team player.
Yeah. But part of that was, and I'll be honest, I've heard different things with interactions with fans at conventions and stuff, but I don't know. I can't judge. It wasn't me. So, yeah, I thought of the green when it comes to Lou. Yeah,
exactly. That was the humor with him.
So, final question that I wanted to tie a bow with everything. And obviously, we tongue in cheek were talking about part of it, but Julie Michaels did recommend you and everything. Love her to death as someone. She's been a great champion, I think, for what I do so far, from what I've heard from multiple people. Yourself, Adam Marcus, the writer, director. And when I talk to other friends and acquaintances of the show that have worked with her and know her, Marshall Teague and whatnot, said, Julie is such a champion for you. And I do appreciate that. But my question being is, how you mentioned earlier about some of the domestic stuff you would do, you know, having kids similar age and whatnot. But how would you describe her as a person? Because there's some things she, in my experience, were all positive, but I don't feel, and I know she didn't do it for look at me kind of deal. But what kind of person would you say she is? Because I think it can't be said enough.
I think the phrase "your ride or die" was made for Julie, because literally unfortunately her cat passed this morning, and she tried very hard doing CPR to her baby of 17 years, and she was crying, and I'm only saying, if I called her as soon as she texted me, but if I called her to tell her some problem with me, she literally would have suppressed that entire thing to just help me out. And she's done that before. You know, she's someone who is always trying, is always helping someone who's going through chemo, someone who's just had some bad accident, someone who can't pay their rent. And so she's helping them, give them work. She's working and hiring someone, finding a job for someone so that they can make their insurance. Like, she goes so much more than just saying really sweet things and thinking nice things. She does things for people. And, you know, she's my emergency contact for the last 28 years. I mean, if that doesn't say anything, you know, I could see that. Yeah. Every official paperwork I've ever signed, you know, husband, mother, daughter, emergency contact, Julie Michaels.
Yeah. And
I mean, even when she went to speak at the Ronald Reagan Museum, she was asked to be a keynote speaker there. And like, she didn't just walk through the door and walk up the audience and onto the stage. Her whole purpose of speaking is to inspire people to do things bigger and better and greater and be more bold and brave, right? Like, ultimately, that's what we want. So she decided to enter that speech by coming in on a helicopter, hanging from it, from a wire outside of it. So the museum where you speak has got a big glass window. So all of the people coming to see her speak, you're looking at the stage, but the stage is right in front of glass windows. So they're all sitting there and they're looking out of the window. And who do they see on a helicopter going by through this field is Julie hanging and gets dropped down and then runs into it and enters that way. You know, so she really melds that combination of having the wisdom to inspire someone, but then doing this beautiful, physical, artistic, poetic action to just really put the cherry on top.
And that might, if that doesn't say about her, that nothing will, but I will, that would explain why I didn't hear a response. And this ain't about me, but I'll have to talk to you off air about it. But hearing about the cat is, you know, but everything you said there, that's her to a T. The woman I've gotten to know over the past couple months as an acquaintance, and hopefully the relationship continues. Positive, folks, before you email me, Facebook, all that stuff. I'm not saying nothing. Yeah. Wrong. But I do want to mention as we wrap here, and thank you for the time, DeniceStuff.com, to see about the photography work, the makeup brands, the acting, just everything all on the website. Also get links for her Instagram, Denice Duff, and all that fun stuff. So is there anything I'm missing here?
Denice Duff, Instagram, Facebook, that's all good. It's the easiest way to get me. You know, my skincare company is In Your Face Skincare, In Your Face Skincare. But yeah, you can reach me. You can DM me on Instagram is probably easiest. The Facebook is, it's full. So I have to kind of go in and accept, and I'm sort of thousands behind. But you absolutely can get me through Facebook or through Instagram, Denice with a C.
Denice, thank you so much.
You are so very welcome. Thank you. This was just an incredible, fun journey.
Appreciate it.
This brand is truly exciting, and so glad that they are starting to make a positive impact. Little Bean Soapery is a woman-owned small business based in Northeast Pennsylvania. Little Bean Soapery does so much, as all products are handcrafted and offer many different things for both men and women. Soaps, scrubs, body butters, bath bombs, solid cologne, and much more. Little Bean Soapery also does things for special occasions such as birthdays, Mother's Day, Father's Day, and special seasonal gift sets. But also, let's not forget large orders for party favors by request. The great things about all products is that they are crafted to be nourishing on the skin. If you wish to check them out, please feel free to visit littlebeansoapery.com. Any questions, please feel free to also email littlebeansoapery@gmail.com for custom inquiries and or ask anything else you wish. Tell them that Elena from Crazy Train Radio sent ya.
Hi, I'm Julie Michaels, and you're listening to Crazy Train Radio.